And then we're also going to geography and going to talk to us all about kind of ecological webs in Pinacate. We also are cooking up a field trip in late October that we're going to announce to go down there. And then we're going to have a second issue of the Proceedings of the Desert Laboratory. It's called Campos de Fuegos, the namesake of this lecture series, which is a fantastic novel written in the late 1920s by Humberto Esquer. It's only been available in Spanish up to now. And we're publishing that again with in English, working with Bill Broyles and Gail and Bill Hartman, and then in collaboration with the Cultural Institute in Sonora. So that's going to be fantastic, and that we're going to have that in our hands in the next month or so in a book launch probably in December. But anyway, to our point tonight, which is the stories of the geology of the region from Dan Lynch. And Dan says all you need to know about him is that he's been kicking around in the Pinacate since the 1970s. Now he's retired and it's turned into an obsession. So he's going to share that with us. Dan, thank you for being here.
Itself, the cone and the lava flows. is the magma source. It's the place where the liquid comes from. And connecting the two is a pipe that goes through the crust. And so we probably might see this. Well, let's talk a little bit about basalt. This is a piece of the Earth's mantle. It was dredged up down in southeastern Arizona in the San Bernardino volcanic field. It's a rock called wurzelite. That's your 50-cent word for the evening. Made of olivine and pyroxene with a few other odds and ends of things. We don't really know how magmas are generated. We know that they are generated, but a lot of it's speculation. The heat is probably carried in to the rock by things like water, carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide. Magma only occurs in certain places, which is why we have volcanic fields. If we look at an analysis, chemical analysis of a rock that I picked up in the field, this is the percentages of the oxides of the eight major elements. And the most important one is the one on the right, which is silica. And what this less than 50% means is that there are too few silicon atoms in the soup to be able to grab a hold of common oxygens and make long buoy chains. And so basalt magmas generally tend to be very low viscosity, as illustrated by this piece of scoria. Notice how round the bubbles are. There was nothing in the liquid that impeded their formation, and so they got to be round. The fact that they're full of soil carbonate indicates that the walls were blown out and all of them had access to the exterior. This is not pumice. Pumice has closed bubbles. The salt will sink. So it'll float for a little bit, but generally it all winds up sinking. Okay. These volatile constituents that are not part of the major element analysis really provide the kinetic energy for eruptions. When they bubble out of the liquid, they build the cone, they toss the bombs, they do the work. And this all occurs within the upper kilometer of the conduit, where the pressure on the liquid is sufficiently low. It's like popping the lid on a bottle of beer. When you drop the pressure over the surface of the beer, the CO2 comes out. Same deal with a volcano. Pinacate is not unusual. There are 50 similar monogenetic volcanic fields within 1,000 kilometers, which is not very large distance. Next question. Where is Pinacate? Well, it's on the Gulf of California, sort of at the end of the Gulf of California. It is on the Gulf, but it is not of the Gulf. Because, here we go. Is this, oh, there we are. Fine, cool. All right, this is Baja California, the San Pedro Martir, and this is a chunk of continental crust that was stolen by the Pacific Plate 7 million years ago and is being carried inexorably toward the Aleutian Trench. It'll take a while. 2 inches a year. It is moving along a complex plate boundary that consists of transform faulting and seafloor spreading, all conveniently hidden under the waters of the Gulf and the sand of the end of the Gulf. Opening of the Gulf was probably the most profound thing that's happened in the last 7 million years, because what it did is it brought base level inland, and it rejiggered the energy balance of all of the rivers. In the vicinity of Pinacate, a tremendous amount of crack that had been accumulating around the basin ranges for several million years was suddenly hauled out and dumped into this gigantic new dumpster that had been opened up a little bit to the west, and process that I call the Great Denudation, which I don't have time to talk about, but it's really fascinating. In any case, the desert surface that we see today is probably no more than 3, maybe 4 million years old. And Pinacate is on that surface. And so Pinacate is younger than 4 million years, maybe 3 million years. The rocks that I did radiometric ages on do not reflect the beginning of the volcanism down there. But I would like to point out this. In the Cordillera, one of the rivers that got rejuvenated became the Grand River, and it cut this Grand Canyon, and it cut a bunch of other stuff, working on down south, and when it got down here, it was too thick to walk on, and too thin to walk on, and too thick to drink. So, I also want to point out here this color of the sand. This is the Gran Desierto de Altar, and it has a decided rosy color, the same with the sand that is a little bit east of Pinacate. And this picture explains it, if I can get it up. This is a CWIFS image from the year 2000. And probably the most important thing is this huge plume of dust that was picked up by a strong northwesterly wind from the delta of the Colorado River and carried out over the blue waters of the Gulf so we could see it. Ordinarily, the wind blows from the south, from the west southwest, and it has a background of sand of the same color. So the question is, where did it come from? Well, if you follow the river, I can get this working, there we go. The river just sort of makes its way across out of the Colorado Plateau, and here is the red beds that created the red sand of the Red River. So that's why it's that way. Who discovered Pinacate? Nobody. People just gradually noticed it while they were doing other things. Starting with Columbus. Well, not really. That was 50 years earlier. But 50 years after Columbus ran into a continent on Earth he expected to be much smaller than it actually was, Hernan Cortes sent Francisco de Ayala up the west coast of New Spain in 1539 looking for the Northwest Passage, and the weather got him and sent him back to Acapulco. But he described his voyage, and the description of his voyage 4 years later resulted in this map by Battista Agnesi. The continents are not too terribly far off of what we know today. But over here on the western side of New Spain, very clearly is a peninsula and a gulf marked in red. Ayala called it Mar de Cortez after his patron. Everybody else called it Mare Vermejo or Mare Vermilio, the Red Sea, because of the red beds that colored the water. Not since the first dam have those red beds come down the river. Okay. 1569, Gerardus Mercator, he also showed a peninsula and gulf, and in red, underlined in red, a little town on the side of the gulf listed as P de S. Clara, or Puerto de Santa Clara. And from this map onward, that town was part of the common geographical knowledge. 1600, Arnoldo di Arnoldi, Peninsula, Gulf, and Puerto de Santa Clara. And then some Dutchmen got a hold of a stolen copy of Spanish sailing directions, and their perception of the world changed a bit. This is Jacob Lemaire, 1622. He showed California as an island. Now, bear in mind, these guys are all sitting in Europe. Their map tables are in Europe, and their pens and pencils are in Europe, and they're writing about something that is a goodly long distance away that they have not seen and are never going to see. So, 3 years later, Henry Briggs of London let his imagination fly. And I love all of the names along the side of that island, but there's Puerto de Santa Clara on that body of water, be it strait or gulf. And from there, to Eusebio Francisco Kino, an apostle in the company of Jesus, who was sent to Baja in 1683 to establish missions, was driven out by drought, wound up in P. Maria Alta in 1687. Bolton, his biographer, insists that this was the map that he had. Teatro de los Trabajos Apostolicos de Jesus. All right, if he's going to be supplying missions, the question is, how do I get the stuff across the Gulf? If it's a strait, got to be by ship. If it's a gulf, it might be by wagon train around the end. So, being smart, he climbed to the top of the highest mountain he could find, hoping to see the end of said gulf. Alas, his visual horizon at 1,200 meters altitude was only 125 kilometers, and so he could not see anything at sea level beyond the limits of that yellow circle. He decided, based on some blue mollusks that were in the trade goods, that it was in fact a gulf, even though he didn't see it. But the one thing he did was to name the mountain Santa Clara, presumably after that village. And so it was, for the next 160 years, the mountain was called Santa Clara. Here's one from 1844, you can see right here, Cerro de Esclaro, a bunch of different spellings. The most important thing to know about this name is that everybody in Europe knew it, and everybody in the eastern United States knew it, but the folks who lived around the base had no clue. What they had was their Eliotes beagle, Pinacate, in the Navajo language, and their black mountain, Pinacate. Makes sense. The next two guys in my story are Herman Ehrenberg and Charles Poston. These guys were a couple of gentlemen adventurers who were prowling around the Gadsden Purchase looking for a railroad right-of-way for a slave state's transcontinental railroad. Poston wrote in his diary about going across Pinacate Mountains, an extinct volcano. And he mentioned a coast range of mountains called Pinacates after the Black Beetles, in parentheses. It's unfortunate, but this diary was only published 3 years ago in a book by Storms, Reconnaissance in Sonora. But this is the map right here. Gadsden's map of the, or excuse me, Ehrenberg's map of the Gadsden Purchase. It is the very first place that the name Pinacate appeared on a piece of paper off a press. Changed the name on the second version, but that's okay. It stuck. His track with Poston is probably that blue line. Bill Hartman thinks that's true because of the distance they traveled. This will become important because of something that's on this map, which has no authors. This is an 1857 map of the proposed Arizona Territory. Will bring your attention to these two things. One is Pinacate Peak with an E, and the second thing is this three-word phrase down showed up on 4 maps published in the 1850s. And there's no record of why it should be there. So, 50 years after Ehrenberg, Godfrey Sykes drew this map of the Pinacates to accompany Hornaday's book, Campfires on Desert and Lava, and then he, right and forever, put the name Pinacate on the volcanic features, naming this the Pinacate Lava Fields. He also labeled clearly the Pinacate Mountains, plural, with Pinacate Peak and Carnegie Peak, also prominently labeled. So what is it? Is it a Cerro or is it a Sierra? If you look at the outline of the sky, you can see 2 peaks, so they're perfectly reasonable to think of it as a range of mountains. But if we look at that a little bit more closely, this is the very top of the mountain. That's Pinacate Peak, which is a Pinacate cinder cone. And that's Carnegie Peak, which is a Pinacate cinder cone. And these are the Lumholtz cones. And this is a Pinacate lava flow slurping down the surface of the side of the mountain. And this is Bonillas, which is a Pinacate cinder cone. But there's that stuff. I'm a good Pinacate explorer, and eventually I notice things when I'm looking for something else, and I notice the difference between basalt and that light-colored rock around it. Dozens of geologists had climbed through this stack of flows on the side of this mountain on their way to the summit and paid them no heed at all. But I collected samples and took them back to the laboratory where I was doing my dissertation work, and I analyzed them. And this is what I found. Pinacate Mountain is not a Pinacate volcano. This is a Harper diagram. It shows graphically the comparison between silica content along the horizontal axis and sodium and potassium contents along the vertical axis. All of the Pinacate analyses are neatly contained within that tight little closed curve. But the mountain's rocks are not neatly contained. In fact, they are scattered, and they constitute a highly evolved rock series. So, not to belabor a point, but I figured out that those rocks came from the same magma body as its composition changed over hundreds of thousands of years by the removal of iron, magnesium, and calcium from the liquid by high bond energy minerals. And that resulted in concentrations of silica, sodium, and potassium in that liquid. Okay, this is a geochemist's volcano, and I can't take any really good photographs of it that show its geology. But the Pinacate cones are monogenetic volcanoes. The mountain is a trachyte shield volcano. The type was described in the African Rift. By calling it Volcan Santa Clara, I used Kino's old name for it, which was recommended by Ronald Ives a number of years ago. He didn't particularly like the name Pinacate. But I think that gives me a really cool segue into the next part of this business, which is a discussion of the giant Mar Calderas. And there is Sykes Crater again, seen from a slightly different viewpoint. If you look out here over the desert.
No, there.
Yeah, it's just this is not really the rarest phenomenon in the world, because among those 50 volcanic fields that I showed you in the other slide, about a third of them have hydrovolcanoes. So hydrovolcanoes occur in a lot of places. It's just that the ones at Pinacate are really spectacular. And one of the reasons they're really spectacular is they're not full of water. Because Mar, M-A-A-R, is a local word in the German of the Eifel district in Germany. It means lake. And the Mar craters in the Eifel district are all full of water. You can't see what they look like. 500 magmas came through that self-same groundwater reservoir to make the Pinacate volcanoes. Only about two dozen even noticed that the water was there. And we have three giant Mar calderas. A lot of people, not us of course, look at them and think that they're meteorite impact structures. This is real from the Colorado Plateau. It has sort of roundish walls and the rock is really disrupted. Other people say pit crater. Well, this is the world's biggest at Holly Mountain. In an image made in 1961 when it was 800 feet deep. It has changed its depth numerous times. I understand it's back to being pretty deep these days since the magma drained off to make the recent eruptions along the side of the mountain. This is Elegant Crater, which is the largest of the Mar calderas. Go to the screen again. If we start with that lava flow right there, the topmost lava flow, there's a third of a cubic kilometer of space inside that hole. Well, that's a lot of space, bearing in mind that in order to make that space, a lot of stuff had to get pitched out of that hole. Okay, I am probably one of the luckiest geologists you'll ever listen to, because my first job out of college was flying patrol planes for the Navy. And in its wisdom, the Navy sent my squadron to Keflavik, Iceland in 1965, which is 2 years after Surtsey, the big island on the left-hand side, had come up out of the sea. And on my very first patrol, on a brilliant day, with almost no weather at sea. I never saw it that calm again in the 6 months that I was there. I got to see this. It started blowing out of a pile of cinder, and it blew, and it blew, and it blew, and it got up to about 300 meters elevation, and then it started to come back down, and you can see here at the bottom, you can see the stuff rolling out from the base of the cloud called base surge. Trying to get back into the ocean and there's just no room for it anymore. Well, same thing made the giant Mar calderas and the lesser ones in Pinacate. Back here we are to Elegante, looking at the ring of tough breccia around the outside. Those two blocks had to come from one or another of those lava flows we see in the wall, and both of them are in excess of a meter major axis. So they're pretty big. This is tough breccia. We all know what happens to the water when it runs into magma. It gets flashed into steam. What happens to the magma? It's turned into a hydrated basalt glass called palagonite, which has a characteristic sort of yellowish tan color. And the eruption is taking place, the explosions are taking place at a very shallow depth, probably not more than 100 meters below the bottoms of that stack of lava flows we saw in the picture. And in that eruption site is the disruptive blocks of older basalt, cobbles and pebbles and sand from the alluvial basin fill, and this all gets tossed into the air, characterized by very high energy sedimentary structures. And this block of old basalt flow smacked into this stuff when it was wet and made a very nice little impact structure on the side. Very cool. Okay. Carl Lumholtz, 2 years after Hornaday, rode his horse up the side of Santa Clara and looked out over the land to the northeast and saw this big hole in the ground and thought it elegant. This is from the Mallow one spring down in the bottom, looking at Gutmann's cone. Jim Gutmann did his dissertation on this section of the volcano and generally on the Mar caldera. This is another part of Gutmann's cone. It's a large dike that went off into the cinder. Not everybody dug a big hole in the ground. This is Cerro Colorado, which erupted into the east side drainage and dammed Diaz Playa behind it. So let's take a look at a couple of the monogenetic eruptions, just for a little bit of change in pace. This is the Ives flow, named after Ronald Ives. It's the southernmost flow in the field, and 97% of its surface is Pohoihoi. It's a little bit of Hawaii in Pinacate. You can pick it out on this photograph because of the mottled surface. The eye flow is mottled, nobody else is. It's big, 40 square kilometers, 2% of the area of the field, maybe a quarter of a cubic kilometer of basalt, all told. Unlike any of the other Pinacate volcanoes, the eye flow did not have a large pyroclastic cone at its source. Instead, it's got these piddling little spatter ramparts around the fissures. This is one of them. I call it a spatter castle. It's hollow, and it shows how versatile a geologic material basalt is as it transitions from a liquid to a solid. This thing came bloop out of the fissure, built vertical walls up to a meter thick just by piling up these cow pies on the side. And as a matter of fact, it is so versatile that it was able to glue onto the overhanging top and build a partial roof on the top of this spatter castle. It's really quite amazing. It takes a bit of work to get there, but it's well worth it if you get a chance. Well, Pohoihoi is characterized by liquid flowing tubes. What happens is the surface freezes and it stays in one place and the liquid moves underneath. And so on the Ives flow, the sand that was blown from the desert onto the lava was picked up by whatever rain fell on it and carried down to the low areas. And this gave the mottling appearance to the lava. This has an argon age of 13,000 with an error of 3,000, and that is incredible. That 13,000 years ago, don't you remember that? That was a pretty spectacular eruption. Okay, let's go up a bit and look at Carnegie, which was named for this very laboratory. Maybe it was named for old Moneybags himself, I don't really know. But it erupted onto the edge of the summit platform of Santa Clara, right on the edge. So what happened is that the cone was partially built when the wall on the downhill side could no longer support itself, and it slurped off down the side. was called Ye Toy's Cave, and it was a holy place for the Ha Sed Oatom. But when the Anglos started prowling around Pinacate in the early part of the 20th century, the elders went out and removed all of the material from it, and essentially, I guess, called it like a desecrated church. All right, here is another source of the black ground, and that's on the in Lava Canyon. This is a picture of that from space. Here is the main vent, and it is clearly the source of the gray that went on down the side of the mountain and also came around Red Cone, which just happens to be really red in this photograph. If you want to climb the peak, that's where you start from, at the base of Red Cone. Why I wanted to put this picture in is to show, particularly right here, this is an arroyo. You can see that the salt is in the arroyo. Okay. The salt got into this arroyo, and that sort of protected it from heat loss, and it was able to flow down the side of the mountain all the way out into the desert. I used to be able to draw lines, but I can't do it with this Mac machine. But it came down here, you can see it, and this is a headland right here. Went across the front of the headland. Here's another old headland right here, surrounded by the flat desert surface. And what it did was it built a dam across this little canyon right here. And that dam stopped the flow of dust down the side of the mountain and made a place where the Tohono planted tepary beans, and according to Gary Nabhan, were able to get a pretty good crop in a single monsoon season. At least this is his story, if not necessarily mine. Okay, well, we looked at the biggest lava flow in the field, we might as well look at the smallest one. This is one I call Volcancito Coyote, or a ratty coyote that I did get a good picture of when he went sneaking by me the day that I was out there. It's real little. It's 300 meters across the top and about between 80 and 100 meters wide. It's maybe 20,000 cubic meters of basalt. It's one of those magma bodies that didn't have enough oomph to really do much once it got to the surface. I'm sure there are magma bodies that got pretty high in the crust and just ran out of gold. There have to be, statistically. Okay, here's another picture of it. It's just a bunch of spatter vents along the uphill side. I would guess, based on the erosions, on the order of 100,000 years, which brings us to the star of tonight's show, which is Tepelote Volcano, named after some ground owls I found in the side of the cone back in 1973. If you look at it from the side of Elegon Crater, that's from the parking area, it looks like your ordinary garden variety cinder cone. It is not. This is the world's goddamnest volcano. There is one in the world, and it's in Pinacate. No one has ever described anything that's remotely like it. I think it's even stranger than I thought last year, but I haven't got that story put together yet. Let me point out a couple of things. First of all is this gray stuff. Call this the cinder block. It's sort of on the south end of the crater. I think it's $1 million worth of architectural grade cinder, maybe even more at today's prices. Another thing is this lovely brown velvety texture to the cone slopes. I mean, great stuff. And then over here, you can see some enigmatic lines on the ridge. Yeah, they are enigmatic. Okay, there's more to the story. If we step back a couple hundred miles, and looking at it from space, you can see a very large cinder plume that is so prominent, it's one of the first things you see when you look at a space image of the field. This is it seen from directly overhead, space shuttle pictures. It is maybe 9 by 7 or maybe 12 by 9 or maybe 15 by fill in the blank, because you can pretty much draw the line anywhere you want to. I helped a young grad student from ASU 2 years ago, and she went down and she dug 60 pits in the desert, and she measured clasts and determined that that cinder blanket consists of two identifiable parts. There's no contact between them because nothing happened to make a contact, but they may have been separated by some amount of time. This is another one of those little enigmas. Now, cinder is a special kind of pyroclast. This is from Hawaii back in the 60s. Cinder cones are the most common volcano on Earth. But cinder is pretty rare. Any of you who bake are familiar with meringue? You beat air into egg whites. All right, the air or the volatiles are already in the liquid and they nucleate in profusion when this stuff is in about the top 500 meters of the conduit. They nucleate and grow and squeeze the liquid into thin sheets between the bubbles they break out right away and squeeze it into filaments between the bubbles, and you wind up with something like that. The result is that the volume of the basalt increases by a factor of 10, and the velocity of the basalt increases by a factor of 10, and these things will blow a couple of kilometers in the sky. And cinder is so light that it's wafted by the hot air and can travel quite long distances downwind. So that's why the cinder plume around Pinacate covers such a wide area. Okay, I put this one in here to point out the lava flows. Probably the only thing I'm going to do is point out this. This is the Q flow because it crudely resembles the script letter Q. It has a cinder path across it, which makes walking across it trivially easy for even the oldest of elderly geologists. Same thing for the S flow down here on the south. It is a really delightful 20-minute walk from the road to the base of the cone across the S flow. There are 6 more lava flows around this volcano. None of the other ones in Pinacate had this. All of the others are black airfall cinder, which indicates that they were extruded after the cinder phase of the eruption. Just to point out right here that the interior. Four craters that go across will line up. Let's see how many. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe this, maybe this. Then we've got an axial set. There's this one and this one, and this one and this one and this one. And then there's a little explosion pit right down here to sort of cap things off. I'm not even going to begin to think that I might be able to figure out what happened in this crater at the end of this eruption. Remember those lovely velvety brown walls that I showed you earlier?
Oh.
That's what they are. They're bombs. And those bombs are 1/2 meter and larger. The death march the first day that we went out together, and didn't faze her in the slightest. That particular block behind her is 2 meters diameter, at least 12 tons mass, metric tons. Here are some meter plus bombs up in what I call the West Bomb Basin. The whole top of the cone is covered with bombs. And then this one is the bus bomb over on the north side. There's Richard Larne and his son standing on it. I've estimated the mass of this ton, of this block, to be 50 tons. And it flew. It has fluidal textures of flight on the sides. Okay, let's go back and look at the top of the volcano again. This is what I call the Graben Ridge, because it is. And if we look at it from ground level, right next to me is a 2 meter high vertical fault scarp. You can trace that scarp all the way around and up onto the ridge of the cone. There's another one and another one and another one. It's just laced with them. Well, I can't draw pictures on this, but if you imagine what this used to be, it ought to have been a smooth arc over the top, but it's W-shaped now because the top of the ridge subsided into the ridge. This is what it looks like from the other side. And from overhead. Look at these goddamn faults. Look at them. This one comes along and is pretty happy to be parallel to the axis of the ridge and decides, oh, to hell with it, and runs off down slope and then swings around and goes parallel to the ridge again. I timed this picture so that I could catch the ridge just as the sun was parallel to the outside surface. So all of the outside faults are lit by the sun on their upslope sides, and all of the upslope, all the faults on the other side are in shadow on their upslope side. The thing just sort of sunk into the ridge, and it gets worse. Again, I can't draw these on the screen, but you can see there's a problem, and there's a problem, and there's a problem, and there's a problem, and there's a problem. One right after another. Oh, yeah, there's these little two pit craters, which are sort of like cherries on the sundae. But if we go across to the other ridge, it also is sliced and diced by faults. None of them straight, all wandering all over hell, and at 90 degrees to the first set of faults we looked at in the previous slide. This is what it looks like looking down from overhead. On the lowest of the faults, that's pretty sharply down. And then on the upside, these are down. What a mess. It melted. I can't explain it. It melted. It seems obvious looking at it that this volcanic edifice was built by an eruption that probably lasted more than average time, but it built a cone, and that cone was sitting there in the sun when something, volatiles, I don't know, came up the conduit, and the rock that was in the cone, it's scoria, it's full of bubbles, like the stuff you saw earlier in the presentation. That rock was solid, and it remelted and became liquid again, and when it became liquid, the bubbles collapsed. And when they collapsed, support for the carapace was lost, and the carapace sank in along a series of faults in one situation, and also along some valleys that appear to have melted in the side of the volcano. And these three places, there seemed to be secondary lava flows that came out of the base of the cone. I don't think I would be able to defend that if I were doing my dissertation today.
some of your friends, the volcanic bombs, who traveled through the earth.
Over a kilometer. Now, I didn't tell you that the Tecolote volcano is accompanied by two friends. One I called the battered cone, and the other I called Mayo, after my first structural geology professor. The battered cone is old. It's maybe 500,000. It's a red scoria that's being taken apart by erosion, and it got covered over by some stuff from the Tecolote eruption. And it is covered with large blocks of basalt that I'm no longer willing to talk about. And it's also covered by textured black volcanic bombs that had to have come from Tecolote. And that's a kilometer and a half distance. And these are big. These are good-sized blocks. For reference, a sphere of 83 centimeters diameter is a metric ton of basalt. So these are substantial chunks of basalt that got propelled goodly long distances. And of course, the absolute profusion of bombs on Tecolote, you can't call it a cinder cone, it's a bomb cone.
And these examples you brought in.
Yeah, I brought some. This one's my ding bomb. It has a pretty good sized ding in one side because it got hit by something or because it hit something else. And there's a whole bunch of them back there on the table that you can pick up and ask yourself the question, why on earth would this guy carry something like this on his pack halfway across a volcano? Again, I was much younger. Okay, well, thanks for coming.
Thank you very much. And thank you all for coming. If you are interested in the subsequent talks coming up, if you haven't signed up, I recommend you do so very quickly. They're filling up very fast these days. We had a week.